morning. Today we are going to cover the white matter of cerebrum. So white matter consists of bundle of nerve fibers with the associated neuroglia, and this is seen deep to the cerebral cortex, that is deep to the gray matter, and it forms most of the bulk of the cerebral hemisphere. So the white matter can be classified as three types of fibers, that is association fibers, commissural fibers, and projection fibers. Association fibers are a bundle of white matters which connect the different parts of the cerebral cortex within the same cerebral hemisphere. So that is association fibers. Association fibers can be short association fibers or long association fibers. Short association fibers are white matter that is connecting to adjacent gyri by hooking around the sulcus. So that is short association fibers. For example is this. This is the central sulcus. This is the upturned edge of the central sulcus, and this is the short association fiber around the central sulcus. So that is short association fiber. Coming to long association fiber, they are traveling for long distances and they connect different lobes of the cerebral hemisphere. So examples for long association fibers are cingulum. Cingulum is the association fiber that is seen on the medial aspect. Then we have superior longitudinal fibers that is seen on the supralateral aspect. There is inferior longitudinal fibers that is seen on the tendorial surface. Then there is frontooccipital bundle and uncinate vesicles. So coming to cingulum. Cingulum is this long circular bundle of association fibers that is extending from the paraterminal gyrus up to the uncus. It is extending all the way in a circular manner up to the uncus. So it is seen over the cingulate gyrus and also the parahippocampal gyrus. So that is the cingulum. It is in a circular manner. So that is why the name cingulum. The word meaning of cingulum is girdle. It is extending from the paraterminal gyrus to the uncus. And it is seen on the medial aspect. Coming to the supralateral aspect, there is superior longitudinal fibers that is extending from the frontal lobe and connecting it to the occipital and the temporal lobe. So here we'll have the superior longitudinal bundle that is seen on the supralateral aspect. Then on the tendorial aspect, we have the inferior longitudinal bundle that is connecting the visual association area of the occipital lobe to the temporal pole. So that is the inferior longitudinal bundle that will be seen on the tendorial surface. Then we have the frontooccipital bundle. So frontooccipital bundle is seen on the medial aspect. That is also connecting the frontal pole to the occipital and temporal pole, like the superior longitudinal bundle. But the superior longitudinal bundle is on the supralateral aspect and frontooccipital bundle is on the medial aspect. It is seen deep to the superior longitudinal bundle. Then next association fibers is uncinate vesicles. Uncinate vesicles connects the motor speech area and the orbital surface of the frontal pole to the temporal pole. So that is the fibers that hooks in this arched manner around the stem of the lateral sulcus. So that is the uncinate vesicles. So these are the various long association fibers. Then coming to the next set of fibers, that is commissural fibers. Commissural fibers connect the identical or corresponding areas of the two cerebral hemispheres. So they're interhemispheric fibers. Association fibers were connecting different parts of the same cerebral hemisphere. So they were intrahemispheric fibers, whereas commissural fibers are connecting the identical areas of the two cerebral hemispheres. So they are interhemispheric fibers. So these bundles are called commissures. So examples for that are anterior commissure, posterior commissure, habenular commissure, hippocampal commissure, corpus callosum. Corpus callosum is the largest commissural fibers in the cerebral hemisphere, and we have the optic chiasma. Optic chiasma is also an example for commissure. So the different examples are anterior commissure, posterior commissure, habenular commissure, hippocampal commissure, the corpus callosum, and the optic chiasma. First coming to the corpus callosum. Corpus callosum we have already studied. It's a C-shaped structure that we see in the medial surface. It is actually an arched interhemispheric bridge that is connecting the two cerebral hemispheres. And the various parts of the corpus callosum are the genu. The anterior end is curved, so it is called genu. Then the trunk of the corpus callosum, the splenium. And the genu is extending downwards and backwards, and this part is called the rostrum. So there are four parts: the rostrum, genu, the trunk, and the blunt end that is called the splenium. So through this different parts of the corpus callosum, the fibers will pass through these four parts and it will connect the identical areas of the two cerebral hemispheres. So it is the largest commissural fibers that are seen in the cerebral hemisphere. Holding the brain in anatomical position, this is the frontal pole and this is the occipital pole. So this set of fibers that we see at the floor of the medial longitudinal fissure, that is the corpus callosum. And we can see the fibers, nerve bundles that are passing through the corpus callosum into various aspects of the cerebral hemisphere. So the fibers that are passing through the anterior aspect, through the genu, will sweep anteriorly and connect the identical areas of the two frontal poles. So it will sweep anteriorly in a fork-like manner. These fibers, that is arching anteriorly and connecting the two identical areas of the frontal pole, are called forceps minor. This fork-like structure, these fibers are called forceps minor. Similarly, we have fibers passing through the trunk and the splenium, which is going to connect the different areas. Fibers that are passing through the trunk of the corpus callosum is going to connect identical areas of the frontal lobe and the anterior part of parietal lobe. The fibers that are passing through the splenium will connect the identical areas of the posterior part of parietal lobe and the occipital lobe. Through the occipital pole, the fibers will sweep backwards and it will form another fork-shaped structure. This fork-shaped structure, that is called forceps major. So the fibers that are passing through the genu and forming a fork-like structure passing towards the two frontal poles, that fork-shaped structure is called forceps minor. And the fibers that are passing through the splenium towards the two occipital poles, that fork-shaped structure is called forceps major. So we have forceps minor anteriorly and forceps major posteriorly. This is the another section showing the different fibers that is passing through the corpus callosum. We can see the fibers passing through the corpus callosum. So we know that in the anterior end we have the genu. Through the genu, the fibers that are passing, sweeping anteriorly towards the frontal pole, and these fibers are called the forceps minor. These fibers are called the forceps minor. And from the splenium, you have fibers sweeping posteriorly towards the occipital pole. So these fibers are called the forceps major. Both the sides, it is going to form a fork-like structure. So this is the forceps major and this is the forceps minor. Certain fibers of the posterior aspect of the trunk and the splenium of the corpus callosum, that is going to arch over the parietal lobe and pass inferiorly towards the temporal lobe. These fibers that can be seen arching over the parietal lobe and just going inferiorly towards the temporal lobe, and these fibers are called tapetum. And they form an important relation for the lateral ventricle. The cavity of the cerebral cortex is the lateral ventricle. So it is forming a lateral relation for the lateral ventricle. So that we'll study in detail later. These fibers are called tapetum. The specialty of tapetum is that they do not intersect the coronary edema. These fibers do not intersect the fibers of coronary edema. So that is about tapetum. So these are the different parts of the corpus callosum, and with the concavity of the corpus callosum, this is the lateral ventricle. We get the different parts of the lateral ventricle, and the relations of the various parts of the lateral ventricle to the corpus callosum, we'll be learning it later once we learn the lateral ventricle. So that is about the corpus callosum. So coming to some important features in the medial aspect, so we have learned this is the corpus callosum. From the lower border of corpus callosum, there is a septum that is extending downwards. This septum is called septum pellucidum. And the septum pellucidum connects it to this structure that is called the fornix. So there is corpus callosum, then we have the septum pellucidum, and the lower border of septum pellucidum, this structure called the fornix. And fornix is a set of projection fibers that connects the mammillary bodies to the hippocampus. We'll be learning it in detail later. So that is the fornix. Then we have the other commissures that we have to study. So we learn the largest commissure is the corpus callosum. The other commissures which connects the identical areas of the two cerebral hemispheres is, this is called the anterior commissure. So this is the anterior commissure. There are two components for anterior commissure, that is neocortical component and paleocortical component. The neocortical component connects the anterior inferior aspect of the temporal lobe, and the paleocortical component connects the olfactory bulb and the olfactory tubercles of the two cerebral hemispheres. So that is the paleocortical component, and these structures are crossing the midline at this level, and that is the anterior commissure that is seen at the lower part of the rostrum. So we have the rostrum, at the lower aspect we have the anterior commissure. So this is the tectum of the midbrain. So we have the inferior colliculus and the superior colliculus. We already studied this is the superior colliculus and inferior colliculus. And above the tectum of the midbrain, this small commissure, which is the size of a pinhead, that is the posterior commissure. So it's a slender bundle of white matter that crosses the midline at this point, and that is the posterior commissure. And it connects the superior colliculus, the pretectal nucleus, and the interstitial nucleus of both the cerebral hemispheres. So that is the posterior commissure. And above that, over here, we get the habenular commissure. Habenular commissure connects the habenular nuclei of both the sides. So we have the posterior commissure and habenular commissure. Between the posterior and habenular commissure, there is a recess over here. That is the recess of third ventricle. Okay, so this is the pineal body. Okay, and this is the pineal recess of the third ventricle. And between the habenular commissure and posterior commissure, we get the pineal recess of the third ventricle. Also, we have the hippocampal commissure, that is connecting the two hippocampal formations of both the sides. And we have the optic chiasma. Optic chiasma is connecting the optic nerves of eyeballs of both the sides. So that is the different commissure. So this is the anterior commissure. Here the pinhead size, just above the tectum, we have the posterior commissure. Then you have the recess, the pineal recess. Above that, you get the habenular commissure. Then coming to the other important features. So this is the septum pellucidum. And if you remove the septum pellucidum, what we are going to see is, this is the one cavity over here, and that is the lateral ventricle, which is the cavity of the cerebral hemisphere. So this is the lateral ventricle. So CSF will flow from this lateral ventricle through a foramen to the third ventricle. So this foramen, this is the interventricular foramen. This is the interventricular foramen, and through this interventricular foramen, it will flow into this third ventricle. This is the third ventricle that is seen between the two thalamus. This is the thalamus of one side. Similarly, we have the thalamus of both the sides. Between this narrow ventricle that we see is the third ventricle. So, from the interventricular foramen, this sulcus that is extending up to the cerebral aqueduct. So, this is the tectum of midbrain. This is the crest cerebrae of midbrain. So, between these two, this is the cerebral aqueduct of Sylvius. Okay, so between the interventricular foramen and cerebral aqueduct of Sylvius, this sulcus that we see is the hypothalamic sulcus, and below this hypothalamic sulcus, this part is the hypothalamus. So the CSF will flow from the lateral ventricle through the interventricular foramen, through the hypothalamic sulcus in the third ventricle, then through the cerebral aqueduct of Sylvius, and then from there it will flow into the fourth ventricle. This is the cavity of fourth ventricle that we have already studied. It is seen between the pons and medulla anteriorly and the cerebellum posteriorly. So this is the tent-like space, that is, this is the upper part, this is the fourth ventricle. So that is how the CSF will flow. And this fissure that can be seen between the splenium and the rectum, this fissure is called the transverse fissure, through which the telechoroidae of the third ventricle enters. And then it will continue as the choroid fissure, which we'll be learning later. The next set of fibers that you have to study is the projection fibers. So we have learned the association fibers connecting the different parts of the same cerebral hemisphere. Then we have learned the commissural fibers connecting identical parts of the two cerebral hemisphere. The next fibers is projection fibers, which is connecting the different parts of the cerebral cortex to other parts of the central nervous system. That is subcortical gray matter and also the brainstem and spinal cord. So the projection fibers can be of two types, that is descending fibers and ascending fibers. Descending fibers are also called corticofugal fibers, which is passing away from the cerebral cortex to the brainstem or spinal cord. And corticopectoral fibers are the ascending fibers which pass from the different parts of the central nervous system, that is the spinal cord, brainstem, to the cerebral cortex. So these are the different types of projection fibers. So, of the neocortex, the two important projection fibers are the corona radiata and the internal capsule. And of the allocortex, we have the important projection fibers are the fornix and the fimbriae. So, we have to learn the internal capsule in detail. So, before we learn the internal capsule in detail, we have to learn some important relations for the internal capsule. So, one of the important relations is the caudate nucleus. Caudate nucleus is part of the subcortical gray matter. So we learned there is the cerebral cortex, which is gray matter. Then deep to that we have the white matter. And within the deep aspect of the white matter, we have the basal ganglia. One of the parts of the basal ganglia is the caudate nucleus, which is forming part of the corpus striatum. And caudate nucleus has got an expanded anterior end, which is called the head of the caudate nucleus. So this is the head of the caudate nucleus. So as we look through the lateral ventricle, we can see this mass, that is the head of the caudate nucleus. And then it has a body and a tail. So the caudate nucleus is a C-shaped structure with a head, body, a curved body and tail. So this head of caudate nucleus is forming an important relation for the internal capsule. So when we take a section, so this is a section that has been taken, a horizontal section that has been taken at the level of interventricular foramen. This is the lateral ventricle and we know this is the thalamus. So when we take this section and when we look at the section, we can see a compact bundle of white matter, a compact bundle of projection fibers that is seen placed between certain important gray matter. So that this compact V-shaped bundle of projection fibers is called internal capsule. And I was telling you about the head of caudate nucleus. So this is the head of caudate nucleus, which is forming an andromedial relation for the internal capsule. So this V-shaped internal capsule is located between the caudate nucleus medially and anteriorly, and the thalamus medially and posteriorly. So medially you have the caudate nucleus anteriorly and the thalamus posteriorly, and laterally we have this lens-shaped gray matter that is called the lentiform nucleus. So the internal capsule is V-shaped and it is situated between the caudate nucleus, head of caudate nucleus anteriorly and the thalamus posteriorly in the medial aspect, and the lentiform nucleus in the lateral aspect. Internal capsule, when it is traced rostrally, we have the corona radiata, and caudally it is going to form the crust cerebri. So internal capsule is the set of projection fibers which connects the cerebral cortex to the brainstem and the spinal cord. Ascending and descending fibers will pass through this internal capsule. So we have to learn that in detail, but before that we have to learn the parts of the internal capsule. Coming to the parts of the internal capsule, there is an anterior limb and a posterior limb. Anterior limb is seen between the head of caudate nucleus medially and the anterior part of the lentiform nucleus. So this is the anterior limb of the internal capsule. So between the thalamus and the posterior part of the lentiform nucleus, this part is called the posterior limb of internal capsule. So there is an anterior limb and there is a posterior limb of internal capsule. Between these two, there is a bend, this area, and that is called the genu of the internal capsule. So we have the anterior limb, the genu, and the posterior limb of internal capsule. There are two more parts for internal capsule that is seen behind the lentiform nucleus, that is called the retrolentiform part, and the part below the lentiform nucleus is called sublentiform parts. So in total, the internal capsule has got five parts: the anterior limb, the genu, the posterior limb, the retrolentiform part, and the sublentiform part. So five parts for the internal capsule. So we said the fibers, ascending and descending fibers, are compactly arranged and they are going to pass through the internal capsule. So we have to learn the different components that are passing through, the different parts of the internal capsule. So we have ascending fibers and descending fibers. So descending fibers, or the motor fibers, are of three types, that is corticopondine fibers, then the pyramidal fibers and extrapyramidal fibers. Coming to the corticopondine fibers. Corticopondine fibers are going to come from the different parts of the cerebral cortex. They're going to pass through the internal capsule, through the crust cerebri of midbrain, and then they're going to relay in the ipsilateral pondine nuclei. So coming from the different parts of the cerebral cortex, the corticopondine fibers can be classified as the frontopondine fibers coming from the frontal lobe, the parietopondine fibers, the occipitopondine fibers, and the temporopondine fibers. So we have four set of corticopondine fibers. So of this, frontopondine fibers are the most numerous, and that is going to pass through the anterior limb, the genu, and the posterior limb of the internal capsule. The frontopondine fibers are going to pass through the anterior limb, the genu, and the posterior limb of the internal capsule. Then we have the parietopondine and occipitopondine. They are going to pass through the retrolentiform part of the internal capsule. And the temporopondine, temporal lobe is below. So temporopondine fibers are going to pass through the sublentiform part of the internal capsule. So frontopondine fibers are most numerous, that is passing through the anterior limb, genu, and the posterior limb of the internal capsule. Through the retrolentiform part, we have the parietopondine and occipitopondine fibers, and the temporopondine fibers are going to pass through the sublentiform part of the internal capsule. Corticotrichine fibers are coming from the different parts of the cerebral cortex. They are going to pass through the corona radiata, through the internal capsule, and they are going to pass through the crust cerebri to reach the basilar part of pons, where we have the pondine nuclei. They are going to relay in the ipsilateral pondine nuclei. From here, the fibers are going to cross the midline and go to the contralateral cerebellar cortex through the middle cerebellar peduncle. So this pathway is called the corticopondocerebellar pathway. And this is the latest in the development, and in man this corticopondocerebellar pathway is well developed. So it is going from the cerebral cortex to the ipsilateral pondine nuclei. From there it is going to the contralateral cerebellar cortex. So that is about the corticopondocerebellar fibers. Coming to the other set of motor fibers, that is the pyramidal fibers and the extrapyramidal fibers. So pyramidal fibers are again classified as corticonuclear fibers and corticospinal fibers. Corticonuclear fibers are going to the contralateral cranial nerve nuclei in the brainstem. So we know in the midbrain pons and medulla we have the cranial nerve nuclei. They are going to go to the contralateral cranial nerve nuclei for the supply of muscles. That is the corticonuclear fibers. And corticonuclear fibers are going to pass through the genu of the internal capsule. Then we have the corticospinal fibers. So corticospinal fibers are passing to the anterior horn cells of the spinal cord of the opposite side for the control of the muscles of the upper limb, the trunk and the lower limb. So these fibers are going to pass through the anterior two-third of the posterior limb of the internal capsule. Anterior two-third of the posterior limb, we have the corticospinal fibers. So that is about the pyramidal fibers. So corticonuclear fibers are passing through the genu, and corticospinal fibers are passing through the anterior two-third of the posterior limb of the internal capsule. Then we have the extrapyramidal fibers. Extrapyramidal fibers are passing from the cortex to the extrapyramidal system. So that is the red nucleus, the corpus striatum, the substantia nigra. Passing to the red nucleus means corticorubral fibers. Passing to the substantia nigra means corticoniagral fibers. Passing to the corpus striatum means corticostriate fibers. So these fibers are the extrapyramidal fibers, and they are also going to pass through the posterior limb of the internal capsule along with the corticospinal fibers. So through the posterior limb you have the corticospinal fibers, and all the extrapyramidal fibers are also going to pass through this posterior limb. So that is about the descending fibers, the motor fibers. So we have frontopondine fibers are passing through the anterior limb, genu and posterior limb. The parietopondine and occipitopondine passing through the retrolandiform part, and the temporopondine passing through the sublandiform part. Then we have the corticonuclear fibers which is passing through the genu, the corticospinal fibers which is passing through the anterior two-third of the posterior limb, and also we have the extrapyramidal fibers are also passing through the posterior limb. So that is about the descending fibers. Now coming to the ascending fibers. Ascending fibers are basically the sensory fibers. These are passing from the thalamus to the cerebral cortex. So we have learned the various sensory pathways, that is the spinothalamic, spinocerebellar, posterior column. In the all these sensory pathways, the first order neurons are in the dorsal root ganglion. The second order neurons are either in the spinal cord or the brainstem, and the third order neurons are in the thalamus. So from the thalamus they are going to the cortex via various radiations. So these are called the thalamocortical fibers or the thalamic radiations, and the thalamic radiations are going to pass to the cerebral cortex via this internal capsule. Based on the direction of the fibers, there are different types of thalamic radiation. So there is anterior thalamic radiation, there is superior thalamic radiation, there is posterior thalamic radiation, and inferior thalamic radiation. So anterior thalamic radiation will pass through the anterior limb of internal capsule to the frontal lobe. From the thalamus, through the anterior limb of internal capsule to the frontal lobe, we have the anterior thalamic radiation. Then we have superior thalamic radiation. Superior thalamic radiation will pass through the genu and the posterior limb of the internal capsule to the frontal and parietal lobe. So that is the superior thalamic radiation. Then we have the posterior thalamic radiation. So posterior thalamic radiation is going to pass from the lateral geniculate body through the retrolandiform part of the internal capsule. The fibers are going to pass to the occipital pole, the visual cortex. So fibers are passing from the lateral geniculate body through the retrolandiform part of internal capsule backwards. They are going to arch backwards towards the visual cortex. So this radiation is called the posterior thalamic radiation or the optic radiation. They are also called the optic radiation. And then we have the inferior thalamic radiation, that is passing inferiorly towards the temporal lobe in the primary artery area. So the fibers are going to pass from the medial geniculate body through the sublendiform part of the internal capsule to the primary auditory cortex, and that radiation will be called auditory radiation or the acoustic radiation. So the inferior thalamic radiation is also called acoustic radiation. The posterior thalamic radiation is also called optic radiation. Then we have the superior thalamic radiation and the anterior thalamic radiation. Through parts of the internal capsule through which these thalamic radiation pass is very important. The anterior thalamic radiation will pass through the anterior limb. The superior thalamic radiation will pass through the genu and posterior limb. The posterior thalamic radiation will pass through the retrorendiform part, and the inferior thalamic radiation will pass through the sublendiform part. The motor fibers and sensory fibers are compactly passing through this internal capsule. If there is any problem in the blood supply of the internal capsule, all these fibers can get affected, and there can be widespread paralysis and sensory loss of the opposite half of the body. So blood supply of internal capsule is very important, the details of which we will be studying in the lecture course.